Hello, all you cool cats and kittens. This is week 12 in Western Civ, so I thought I would give a little mini lecture on video for you covering an overview of the Hundred Years' War, and we'll also talk about a very timely thing, the plague, the bubonic plague. Last time there was like a major pandemic was 100 years ago, but 700 or so years ago there was perhaps the most famous pandemic. So, it's kind of a timely topic that I thought it might be fun, lols, to discuss just a little bit. Fun being relative. So, 100 Years' War, what was it? How did it begin? It's one of the more famous wars that's kind of discussed in history just because it has a cool name, 100 Years' War. We'll discuss why that's a little fallacious in just a second, but basically, this came about between the French and the English. This was a French versus English event, and in the 13th century, so the 1200s, we're firmly in the Middle Ages now. There was an intermarriage between the French and English royal families. This is pretty common. I mean, this is like rich people usually marry other rich people. Nobles marry other nobles. Royalty marries into other royalty, so it's not so uncommon. What ends up happening though is this very special circumstance where the French king Charles IV dies in the year 1328, and France needs a new king. Like there's really no like direct lineage. There's no like direct heir from Charles IV, so it kind of goes out to the wider royal family. And because there's this intermarriage between the English and French royal families, both of the extended families have a claim to the French throne. So this now you have kind of two countries laying claim to the crown of France, which is an ish. At first, the English king, who is Edward III at the time, is not too concerned about this. He's like, look, I have a kingdom to run. Yeah, it'd be nice to have France, but that would take a lot of time and resources to press this claim. Like, it's going to take a long time to figure out. But France, at the time, the kind of caretaker to the throne and some of the other noblemen, they interfere in what England considers to be domestic events. Like, England was fighting a war with their neighbor, Scotland. And France interfered on the side of Scotland. And this pissed off Edward, who then declares war on France. He concludes the war with Scotland. He focuses all of his energies on getting revenge against France for trying to help out Scotland. And he's like, you know what? Great. This is my, I'm getting revenge, and I'm also going to press this claim to the French throne. So the Hundred Years' War is officially on. It's a Hundred Years' War in the sense that it spans about that long. It's actually a little bit longer. But it covers the span of really two centuries if you look at it chronologically. So it's the Hundred Years' War is not one continuous war of like a hundred like a literal 100 years of fighting. They took long breaks. You can divide the war up into three phases, which is what I'm doing. So it's three really long wars kind of strung together. We call it the Hundred Years' War because it sounds fun. But it's actually like 108 years or something. So phase one is this early period where for about 70 years, the English are just beating up on France. The English have a few different advantages. They have better weapons technology, the longbow. The longbow is this, what you can see here in the picture. It's a bow that's about the length of a man. This is like 5.5, 6 feet. Sometimes they're taller than the average person. And they can shoot arrows really, really long distances. Now, it's expensive and costly to make these bows, but once you have them and you've trained enough guys to use them, they are devastating on the field of combat. So the English have the advantage of long-range weapons, whereas the French, they have bows too, but it's normally in the form of crossbows, which are much more shorter range. They have better kings, better generals, better commanders in the field. The English leadership is just all around more competent. And they also have allies right next to France in the small kingdom. Well, it's a duchy, but whatever. Burgundy. So they have allies in the Burgundians. Here's a map to give you an idea. So this is France. By the end of phase one, everything in like light purple, magenta, periwinkle, I don't know. Everything is controlled by the English in the shade, which is amazing. So like almost half of France, as we know it today, is controlled by English armies, which includes, you know, the entire northern third, including Paris. Paris falls under English domain. Bordeaux on the west coast of France. So the Kingdom of France has like shrunk in size by 50% by the end of phase one. This is not looking good for France. There's a few different important battles you can kind of see here. And then there's Burgundy on the eastern flank. It's a region of France. Burgundy gets assimilated into the French kingdom after the Hundred Years' War. But at the time, it's an independent duchy, and they're allied with the English. So the French are essentially fighting a war on three fronts. Not good. Phase two is when this famous character, Joan of Arc, comes into play. And there's a lot of mythos. There's a lot of kind of mystery surrounding Joan. But she's this inspiring character for the French. Forget that typo. As a teenager, Joan leaves her village. She's just a random French peasant girl. She's not even really French. She kind of comes from this kind of backwater village in the French kingdom, but she wouldn't call herself French. She belongs to kind of a province of the French kingdom that has kind of different loyalties. But anyway, she receives voices from God. And you can chalk this, like if you're skeptical of this idea, you can chalk this up to schizophrenia or she has other mental illnesses. That may very well be the case. Nonetheless, she leaves her village to go and find the French king as a teenager. And impresses the crap out of him because as the story goes, word has circulated around about this peasant girl who's on a quest to find the king of France and deliver France from ruin. The king invites Joan to come see him at court, but is in disguise. Like the king disguises himself as a noble person and puts one of his friends on the throne. And so when Joan enters the court, she looks at the guy on the throne. She immediately knows that it's not the king. And she looks around and she finds the king in the crowd. And this is how, so the king is like, okay, wow. All right. You might be the real deal. You might actually be hearing voices from God. I don't know. But she asks to take a French squadron, you know, like not a really large army. And he allows her to do so because she has so far shown to be very impressive in her own right. And her idea is to go relieve the siege of the city of Orléans, or Orleans, as we would say it, like New Orleans. But Orléans is a strategically placed French city that's on a river, and it's if this city falls to the English, then the English could just come in and attack the rest of France. And she ends up taking this small army to Orléans, relieving the siege and rescuing the city, and starts to win a string of other battles after that. She turns the tide of the war just by being this inspiring teenage peasant girl who hears voices from God. She can't read. She can't write. She wears men's clothing, wears this armor, as you can see in the picture. She dresses in the style of a man. And she's got some weird stuff going on, but she does really well for about a year. Like, in that year, the French see the reversal of their fortunes until Joan gets captured. captured by Burgundians, sold to the English for a ransom, and she is executed by the English in after a lengthy trial, where they find her to be a heretic. She's branded as a Christian heretic, and she's executed before she turns the age of 20. So this really crazy, like, you know, crazy inspiring story that nonetheless launches phase three, which is the end of the Hundred Years' War. France continues this fight and slowly chips away at English holdings in France until the French win. Like, they basically redeem almost the entire rest of their country, all except for the port of Calais, which is on the English Channel, and eventually the French even win that back. So you got to wonder what would happen, you know, if it weren't for this random woman who just kind of comes out of nowhere and leads French armies to victory. It's actually an insane story. While phase one is happening, so that's the Hundred Years' War, that solidifies the kingdoms of England and France in being opposed to each other on opposite sides of the English Channel. We'll talk a lot more about France and England as we go forward, but while phase one is happening of this war, part of the reason why the war takes so long is there's this event that happens, not just in France, not just in England, all throughout Europe, really all throughout the world, where there's a plague that kills a lot of people. Now, the plague comes alongside and runs parallel to other diseases that are pretty prevalent during the Middle Ages. Look, life expectancy was not great. Smallpox, dysentery, consumption, which we now call tuberculosis, measles, cholera. We have vaccines and antibodies for a lot of these diseases today. Like, smallpox is eradicated, but it killed millions and millions and millions of people before the 20th century. And it's crazy to see some of these diseases make a comeback because of the anti-vax movement. But at the time, they were devastating to the population of the West. It keeps the population pretty flat. Like, we don't see a whole lot of population growth in the Middle Ages because of these prevalent diseases. As a result, we don't get very big cities. There's not very many cities, and their populations are pretty low, especially compared to earlier Roman days. We see, you know, kind of, if there's any sort of unit of community, it's in the small villages and towns that dot the countryside in places like France and Germany and England. So into this context, we see the plague, the Black Death, as it's called, where it's an especially dangerous bacterial infection that kills about a third of the population of the West throughout the 14th century. And it never really goes away until antibacterial medicine is invented. So the bubonic plague, what is it? It's this bacterial infection. It's carried by fleas. You might have heard that it's carried by rats, but it's actually the fleas that glom onto rats that carry the disease. And those rats constantly infest the ships in the Mediterranean, especially Italian ships, that undergo trade during the Middle Ages. Like, the main kind of ship-faring culture is the Italians, you know, in Venice and the other port cities. And these Italian ships transport rats, and these rats carry fleas. And so that's how the bubonic plague spreads throughout the West. It actually comes from Asia first, and then it spreads to the West because of trade. So globalization being kind of an incubator for the carrying of not only economic progress, but disease. We get a bit of a mixed bag here. And this has this lasting effect on European civilization. The documents that you can read, and I'm not assigning any documents for this class, partly because it's kind of a depressing topic to read about pandemic in the midst of a pandemic. But it has, you can read a lot of these documents out of Italy and other places that talk about, so many people are dying left and right that people are just desensitized to the idea of death altogether. Like, oh, well, Bob, my neighbor, died yesterday. So what? The rest of my neighbors have died. It's just another drop in the bucket. The social breakdown, violence happens, and people become desensitized to this over the course of many years. And one of the other kind of lasting effects that the bubonic plague has, aside from killing lots of people, aside from desensitizing people, is the survivors of the plague were able to, or those who were either didn't catch it or survived it and had antibodies. Were impervious now to the disease, and they could demand higher wages for their labor. So this enables especially skilled craftsmen, but even just like unskilled laborers, to be in high demand just because there are so many people that are killed. Economic progress has stalled for quite a while in the West, and if you're a survivor of a plague and you have any skills whatsoever, you can do work. You can demand a high price for your work because of the supply and demand effect. So there's a bunch of literature out there about the bubonic plague. I won't bore you with it. It's an interesting topic. You can look it up on your own if you haven't already, as lots of people started looking into this famous pandemic at the beginning of quarantine. And I'm not going to show this now. I don't think I can get the audio properly piped through here on this format, but I'll post the PowerPoint file, and you can watch or listen to the epic rap battle of history between Miley Cyrus and Joan of Arc. I think it's pretty entertaining. Maybe you'll find it amusing as well, but I'll post that up on Blackboard so you can actually access it. All right, guys, have a great week 12. If you have any questions, let me know. Hope you're doing great. Talk to you later. Bye.